بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد Allah عز وجل mentioned in the Quran few things that were very challenging for us. All the narration always go to different route because science at that time did not confirm what the Prophet was saying. At the same time, people did not understand it. If someone believed the Quran just for one century, then he's mistaken. I wanted to learn something very important. Quran always move with the time, always. Every single ayah does not expire. You can bring every single ayah. If you see it expiring, like for example, it's just in a past tense and it doesn't make any sense now, then the Quran does not make any sense. The challenge of Allah Azza wa Jal inside the Quran is moving with the time. What some people think when I say that, they think I am creating a new translation. No, in reality, all the translation that we have in those books are very true. For example, if you bring someone 10 years old, he will translate the Quran great for his age. He will understand the surface. If you bring someone 20 years old, same thing. 30 years old, he's a doctor, he will start to understand new things that he did not know before. Regarding your knowledge will tell you what the Quran is saying. For example, someone is engineer, he will see different things than a doctor who is really educated and who the engineer is really educated and so on. Each one of us have this perspective in the Quran. And the Holy Quran has a challenge too. It's 600 pages only. It speaks about everything in the universe. For example, now if you want to bring a book, it's like 500 pages and it's telling you many information that in the future might be different. Science has proved it different and or so on. But in the Holy Quran, every single us, one of us from the creation is inside the Quran too. If we really know how to interpret it through language, through mathematics, through physics and so on. And this is by itself is a complete science. Yeah, each one of these are very complete science. And I know some people, they've been studying 20 years the Quran through the numbers. Until this moment, they did not reach far enough to really understand what is going on because it's very complicated. It's not as easy as you think. At the same time, some people, they keep saying to me, why you keep claiming the Quran is so hard? I did not claim it so hard. I said the Quran will entertain every single brain as Allah Azza wa Jal created it. It will speak to every single brain. Every single one some of us, they don't really like physics. The Quran still give you morals. Every ayah give you morals, give you something to learn, give you wisdom, or vice versa, or so on. Now one of these ayahs that most of the scholars, they always have trouble explaining. And this is from Surah al-Najm. He said Allah Azza wa Jal over here, ثُمَّ دَنَا فَتَدَلَّ فَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنَ وَأَدْنَى. Then he drew near. Allah Azza wa Jal, he's talking about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he was ascended. He was ascended over there in heavens, and Allah Azza wa Jal, he is speaking in the Holy Quran about this experience. He said, then he drew near, then he bowed. So he was the measure of two bows, or closer still to him. Hala, over here they did not specify who is him. You know, in Arabic, if you really translate this ayah, it will say he was close, very near, very short distance between something very big. Ulama said, now who is that big? Was he close to Allah Azza wa Jal? We are in trouble if we say yes, because all this year, 1,400 years, Islam keeps claiming that Allah Azza wa Jal does not exist in any form. He's not like us, a human. He does not look like us. He's not energy. He's not light in a form of light, photons. He's light in a form of hidayah. Yani, how you claiming in the Quran, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Prophet Muhammad was very close to him. To who? Over here, they said, I was reading today, it is like something ma'nawi, like something with emotions, you know, because they don't really know what is going on. Even from the translation of, from the narration of Ahlul Bayt. Why? Because speaking, many times I read something about Ahlul Bayt. For example, like last time we explained about who is really the whale. Last week I speak about who is really the whale, and our ulama today, they said all these narrations are fake because they wanna run away from explaining these facts. But in reality, those are real facts. Why you're not really learning something else to explain them? So over here we are in trouble if we think only that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was there. They depend on one of the narrations. They said, "No, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam Muhammad was with Gabriel. They were traveling upstairs, and then Gabriel he stopped to a certain place, and he said, Rasulullah, why you stopped? He said, I cannot continue anymore to that place you're going. He said, why? Because he said, if I go inside, I will immediately destroy myself because the energy inside is very high. It's even higher than me. You're the only person who can go inside that place. And then he said, okay, I'll go. So he went inside. They said, four hujub, yani four more levels of higher energy. And then suddenly he was inside. So over here, the narrations keep, and the people who translated those narrations said, was Rasulullah was where exactly? Did he enter that place or not? What is it? Is this what kind of place is this? So in this lecture, inshallah, I'm going to say what is it exactly, and how we can understand it from the science meaning, not just the meaning of narrations. Because if you have narration and you don't really have the right science to translate it, it's gonna take you to a place that you're gonna lose your mind with it. Allah Azza wa Jal, for us to understand anything from the Holy Quran, by the way, the Quran does not have talasim. Yani talasim means something hard to figure out. Why? Because if he have something hard to figure out, then why he sent it? For example, I always mention the letters that in the Quran. For example, Alif Lam Mim. If you ask me, all the ulama, they said, you know, Allah Azza wa Jal want to impress us. He wrote Alif Lam Mim. And we can explain it in any way and form and so on. And then you immediately ask yourself, so why? I mean, he's already impressing us. He already found us. We are already in this universe. We have many things to think about, and we are very limited. He's already impressing us. Why he want to impress us in the Holy Quran this way? And this does not make any sense. When he sent the Quran this form, he wants you to understand it, to grasp it. He gave you the tool to think about it and to see how you can translate that. Does this mean I am the only one who have this explanation? No. All the ulama, when they give you a tafsir, it will be it plus all other tafsir. You see what I mean? Yani, for example, when Alif Lam Mim, they tell you it's so and so. Some of the ulama, some of them, they say if you connect all the wording together, it will come up like Wilayatu Aliin Haqqun Nattaba'u. For example, if you connect them all together and you take off all the word, the repeated word, it will be Wilayatu Ali Haqqun Nattaba'u. And the wilayah of Imam Ali should be followed. If those words, those separate words, if you connect them all together, this is what you will have. Some, they say, no, it's not just that. It's Allah Azza wa Jal saying Alif Lam Mim, those repeated words in the Quran, in the same surah, they will be the most repeated ones. He's impressing you with the balagha, yani with the eloquence of wording, and so on. This is right. This, it will be very right. But it's not limited to what I'm saying, not limited to what they're saying. We always have to struggle to reach the new meaning and the better meaning of the Holy Quran. This is our duty in life. Yesterday we were having, for example, Samsung S1. Now we have S6, right? In the future we're gonna maybe have S20, maybe different companies. We're always challenging with the, we're evolving with the technology to bring better servicing to people. When I say, for example, we need to advance our learning from religion, people think that I'm saying we should create new religion. No, it's not. We are very behind for understanding the Quran. So this ayah will bring many challenges. And for us to unlock these challenges, we have to look here, from this perspective. We don't want to keep talking about the kingdom of God. We're going to see it from here. Can we really tackle something over here to understand what is going on over there? So we're going to speak to this from the form of matter, the creation first. For us to understand where was Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we need to see here what is going on, and then we move there so we understand the concept. Allah Azza wa Jal, He created at the very beginning, the science said that, physics, singularity. Who can define what is singularity? Does anyone know what is singularity? I don't want to go deep into it, but singularity means something came from a singular form, not one singular form. What do I mean by singular form? Form of, for example, I have a face over here, but I don't have a back. Can you grasp this idea? For example, let's say we're sitting in a 2D movie. 2D movie means like you're watching the TV now. You see just one face and there's no other face behind it. This is a singular. So mean it came from one person only. And Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned that in the Holy Quran. وَخَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ He created you from one thing, from one nafs. وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا Later, He said, and then He created the duality of it, duality, and then He created everything else after it. So we confirm now there is singularity and there is duality, right? The singularity is one person that Allah Azza wa Jal created everything from, and then duality. Type. Does the Quran is mentioning numbering? Mentioning the numbers? Yes. Holy Quran, if you open, there's a lot of numbers in it. I'm not saying the numbering of ayat. I'm saying, for example, أحد, واحد, صمد, مثلا, اثنان, ثلاثة, أربعة, خمسة. What is the most important number of all that explaining the throne of Allah Azza wa Jal? Because the ulama keep claiming that Rasulullah was going to the throne of Allah. يعني, where is Allah sitting? This is what they're saying. And over here, astaghfirullah, he's not sitting over there. Allah Azza wa Jal does not sit any place. He is everywhere, while He's not in anything at the same time. This is not a challenge, but if you keep thinking about it, you will grasp this idea. It's important for your life. Many people, they're gonna challenge you with this. So He said over here, وَيَحْمِلُ عَرْشَ رَبِّكَ فَوْقَهُمْ ثَمَانِيَةً So Allah Azza wa Jal, He said in the Holy Quran that in a judgment day, the throne of Allah will be carried by 8. He did not mention 8 what? We go back to the books. He said, what 8 what? They said 8 angels. They will carry the Arshullah. Okay, let's say 8 angels. We start questioning what is exactly the definition of angels and what is the definition of devils from the narration point of view. Not from the understanding of the Quran, from the narration. Because when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam tell us something from 1400 years, depending on the science we're having now, it's gonna be something else. Let me give you an example. For example, we have a narration from Rasulullah said, always clean your fingers over here, your nails. Always clean it under. Why? Because the devil, it sits over there. Type. Do you think that the devil himself, you know, comes and then sit under your nail? No, he does not sit there. But why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that? He said because there's something called viruses inside under your nails. And then if you raise them, all those viruses will be under your nails. So do not start eating your nails because all these viruses will go inside you and will cause your system damages, right? So how did he explain from 1400 years the definition of the virus? He said the virus something bad, he mean harm to you like the devil, so you should always be cleaning them. He did not really mean the physical devil, he meant the viruses that they sit under, that the bacteria that they sit under your nails. So if we're gonna translate this as an angels from the narration of Rasulullah, this is mean no, not the angels. The angels, they carry a work, a certain work. For example, if you do something good to someone else, you can call him an angel, right? Why? Because he's doing a good work, good deed. So from this understanding over here, so we say angels is something as doing from the foundation of universe. Okay? Let me explain it more from the point of view that we're talking about. So the foundation of our matter, if you have any question, please stop me and ask, okay? So far, your understanding? Is it hard so far? Okay. From the understanding of the matter we live in, we have a singularity. The matter, we should define ourselves first, right? So we move to the, who are the 8? We have a singularity. And then from the ayah of singularity, Allah Azza wa Jal said, وَخَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ He created you from one soul. and then he created her duality from it. Not وخلق منها زوجها. Some people say زوجها mean her husband and wife. No, he's speaking about duality. He's not speaking about husband and wife over here. وخلق منها زوجها. يعني شو زوجها؟ And duality of the first singularity. So we have one and two, and then after that, that number three. Number three defined by the regular science from the matter point of view, what we call them, the crowd. We have for example narration that said السر إذا بلغ الإسنان, يعني more than two people, everyone will know it. Why? Because anybody will come at a third person, now we'll be having a crowd. It's not no more dual, it is three people. From the definition of sacred geometry, number three is like a triangle. Triangle means the unlocking energy. We start unlocking the energy. For example, the first pyramids are not constructing of four sides. In reality, you can make pyramids of three sides, right? Energy can be made by three sides. If you bring, for example, two sides now and you put them over here, they can, you put them together and they will fall, right? If you bring three sticks, for example, together, then you will start making something to build upon it, to build on it. So any building you're gonna start build, you have to have those three. You cannot build it on two only. It will immediately fall. So the science, the current science, they call number three is the crowd. We move to number four. Number four, call it the quaternity. Now we start having two pairs. You see, now we are start having two pairs. Those two pairs exist, and for example, when the inside the mother womb, you know, when the baby start forming inside the mother womb, immediately you start having those two pairs. Why? Because Allah Azza wa Jal created it in a form to help each other to start building their body. So the quaternity exists in nature, exists in a formation of matter. I made a whole lecture based on these ones only. That's why I'm moving very fast, because we have different information inside. And then after that, said number five. Number five in matter is life itself. It is defined from many books, even including this book. They said number five is life itself. How? Everything based on number five. And from the sacred geometry, we have five circles and one connecting them together as a six. And then the golden ratio made from square root of five. We have many examples that life came from number five. Everything we have now is from number five. And you can review my other lecture regarding those numbers, because I spoke intensively about them. Number six is the hexadecimal number, is where the sixth circle came in from nothing, from the sacred geometry. Okay, and number seven is the monad. Monad means one unity, something connected everything together to one unity. Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned that in the Quran when He said, "We created a way to heaven, and there are seven heavens. سبعة طرائق عددا to the heaven. There is seven way to heaven, and Allah Azza wa Jal, He put them together as unity." Okay, number eight is the pair of squares. This is remind us of the Kaaba, the Holy Kaaba. Allah Azza wa Jal created the Kaaba from the pairs of squares. He did not create you just one form triangle. No, He put many triangles together from eight sides, and then He created you the Kaaba. Who was Allah Azza wa Jal created from inside the Kaaba? Imam Ali Salamullah Alayhi. Why? Because He is telling us something big. Telling us life itself as we know it now began by the number eight. Now we stop here, because after that, the number 9, number 10, in formation of Islam, we have only number 9. But number 9 only happened in Alam al-Barzakh. Anything in Alam al-Barzakh, Allah Azza wa Jal, He took the number 8 from over here, and then, I'm sorry, not Alam al-Barzakh, Yawm al-Qiyamah. After the number 8, Allah Azza wa Jal, He divided that. Our system, the foundation of wording, if you want to know someone, he's a real scientist or not, you tell him what is the most important numbers, they should be from 0 to 9, that's it. Everything else is formed from those numbers. This is a very deep question, by the way. I could stay 1 hour talking about this, but the foundation of mathematics is from 0 to 9, that's it. Everything else is a repetition of these numbers. Allah Azza wa Jal created those nines only. He did not create more. He just, you cannot do it together and then you will create something else. Okay? So, forming those eights from the science of mathematics, we mentioned all in these books, they said from 1 to 8 is the foundation of the matter we know it now. Maybe in Alam al-Yawm al-Qiyamah, number 9 will become in existence. But over here we see number 9 as a number 9. For example, let me give you an example. Before, like 200 to 300 years ago, scientists started proving, or maybe more, one of them was 1,000 years ago, he was a Muslim, he started proving that the zero exists, because scientists before, they believed zero does not exist. For example, this is number one in mathematics, I have one remote, if I take it away, it will be zero. So does zero exist or doesn't exist? Later they exist, yeah, but it doesn't exist at the same time. So they had a big debate that the number zero does not exist till that scientist came in, and he, by the way, he was a student for Imam al-Baqir salamullah alayhi, and then he started writing those books about number zero, and the very end people, the ulama, start adopting number zero as a real number that exists in life, and it's important, and it's what makes geometry now as a real science, number zero. But if you want to now argue, does number zero exist, you will say yes. Where does it exist? You see, where does he exist? Nobody knows, but it is in existence. That's what make our numbering. For example, number 10, 1 and 0. So number 0, it's an important number. Are you confused yet, or so far so good? Okay. So, from 1 to 8, now we're having in something in matter, type. In something in mathematics, matter, the existence, type. Do we have something else from 1 to 8 that we always see it and will show us wa kana qaba qawsayn aw anna, he was very close as a arrows, or as a two, what do you call them?
Arcs.
Yes, two arcs. Allah Azza wa Jal, he mentioned two arcs. Wa kana qaba qawsayn. Qawsayn in Arabic can be translated to two things. The first one, the arrows, the distance. For example, they used before to use the arrow, so they used to measure it by arrow. Now that you measure it by foot over here. For example, he will tell you, I want to buy this land, it's 100 foot. Before, if they want to measure a land, they used to bring an arrow and they start making arrows, and they say, you know, there's 100 arrow over here. Or different meaning, arrows is something we always use. For example, you write a word, you open an arrow, and then you write something in it, and then you close it. So the word is inside those arrow, meaning like you are making something very special in this word, in the wording of this subject, right? Okay, so let's stick to this one, to the second meaning. You are making something inside this subject. Do I have a proof that we always see it, show you that it is in existence, right? Yes, we have something. Who know it? Yeah, the moon. The moon, we always see it. It's every single day in one of these phases, but we never really thought about it. For example, look over here. This is what we call it, the phases of the moon. If what I'm saying is not right, then we shouldn't be having number 8. We should be having number 12, right? I'm speaking mainly about number 8. How many phases of the moon we have? How many phases we have? We call it phases of the moon. Yeah, every day. No, it's not every day. No, we have phases of the moon. They call it's a real science.
Eight
phases. We have eight phases for the moon. I don't want to mention their names now because they're a little complex, the naming. But the moon has eight phases. Subhanallah. And always Allah Azza wa Jal, in a big science, for example, the formation of matter, he has number 8. The moon and the sun, he has number 8 too. Type. What is the moon and the sun? Why Allah Azza wa Jal, he is showing us the moon as eight phases? I'll explain the eight phases after. Why he is having the number eight in the moon? Because Allah, from the science of Arfan, the sun represents Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Because the sun represents the energy. Without the sun, now we do not exist. It always give us the warm, give us the energy to produce, to make food, for example. Nothing outside can be in existence without the sun. And we should be in a way that not too close to burn, why, and not too far, so it get very cold. This is one of the sciences now that exist in space. So the sun always give this nur. Can someone not see the sun? Like, can someone come to you and argue sun is a hologram? No. It's always in existence. Always it's up over there. Even if there's cloud covering the sky now, the sun is always there. Why? Because you see what's behind it too. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was like that. No one ever could argue about Rasulullah. If they argue like he did not exist. Can someone come to you now and he said, you know, the Prophet Muhammad that you're talking about now, he didn't exist before. Can he say that? No, because he has a lot of proofs. He was mentioned in the Quran, narrations. He changed the Arabian Peninsula. He made something hit, the big hit over there. Nobody can pass the history without studying him. So he does exist. But can someone talk about Imam Ali, say he's not Imam? Yeah, they can. Why? Because he is like the moon. Imam Ali is like the moon. He always start with the edge, the arrow we're talking about. Look at the moon in the corner. Can you see it from the corner to the corner? The corner start by a small edge and then start appearing in the night of 14. It will become very clear. Why 14? Because if you reverse, the number 14 will be 41. What's 41 mean? 41, when Allah Azza wa Jal speak in the Quran, you will be, every one of us will be granted the wisdom and at this age. All the Anbiya will be Anbiya at the age of 41. No one became a prophet before number 41, when he's 41 years old. Why 14 night? Because of the Ahlul Bayt, Salamullah alayhi. He's telling you that all the Ma'sumeen, they were inside that Noor. All together, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was close to kana khaba qawsayn aw adna from it, right? Type. The sun is hitting the moon in very beautiful way. Look at the waves over here. At the beginning, it's just a crescent, you know, and then after that we'll start grow, and then very big, and then we'll start getting small. So if we connect all timing together, the 30 days together, what do we have? We have the ultimate explanation of وَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنَا وَنَّا. He was close between those two arrows. طيب, let's explain what exactly between those two arrows. How can we are connecting the moon and the sun with what happened over there? When Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم was ascended over there, he knew that this nur is a big nur that he was going inside. Was this nur, does that place, was Allah Azza wa Jal or not? Who knows? Yeah, he was a Rasulullah and that in the throne. He was on the throne. And then he was entering this throne. There's four hujub. Hujub mean like something, veils. Four hujub. Those veils, they're a big explanation. And I'm not going to explain what they are exactly, but he entered inside those veils. He continued to this ultimate nur. What was it? Who knows? Was this nur Allah Azza wa Jal? If we say Allah Azza wa Jal, that nur, then we are in trouble now. We're not speaking Islam anymore. So what was it exactly? Who knows?
Nur Nabi Muhammad.
He was the ultimate nur of Rasulullah, what Allah Azza wa Jal called him, Ahmad. You see? There's three names for Rasulullah. Who knows them? In heavens, not over here. Three names. Ahmad. First name, Ahmad. The second name, Muhammad. No, not from the Quran. I said in the Malakut. Muhammad, and the third name, what is it? Mahmud. We have a narration that said, every time, for example, you hear the adhan, especially in the Sunni tradition, they say, وَهَبُّ مَقَامَ الْمَحْمُودَ الَّذِي وَعَدَ. And give him the ultimate place when you call him Mahmud. Yani, Mahmud is connecting Ahmad and Muhammad together. In Yom Al-Qiyamah, inshaAllah, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Habibullah will be your neighbor, what do you call him? We call him Mahmud. He's not Muhammad anymore, he's not Ahmad anymore, he's Mahmud. Both together. He's connecting everything together, all the dimensions. طيب. So Muhammad that traveled from here, he was ascended over there, and this ascendant was mentioned who in what surah? Who knows? In Surah Al-Isra. سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى. Allah Azza wa Jal in Surah Al-Isra is talking about the ascendant. And then in this at this time Allah Azza wa Jal showed him everything. Why? Because basically he is outside time. When someone is outside time, what's happening? He see everything. I'll give you this example back. For example, you are watching YouTube. You're watching a movie. It's a nice movie, you know? And you are inside you want to see what happened at the very end. So what do you do exactly? You bring the arrow, you move it very end, right? You take an hour and a half away. And then you start watching from the very end to see what happened. When you are outside time, you are now outside time. This is why you're doing it. If you bring it back, you can bring it back. You can bring it anytime. Why? Because you are outside that place. We are exactly like that. Ahlul Bayt are able to see it from the outside place. Because Allah Azza wa Jal gave them this power. Allah Azza wa Jal is able to do that too. He created time. Time is a creation. Time only happens over here. Does not happen outside here. For example, how do we measure time? Who knows? By the sun and the moon. We measure time by the sun and the moon. Time. Okay, let's go up to a place that there's a sun always. It will never go away. How can we measure time? Yeah, always there. There's no time. It's not happening. Even though some people they think will continue evolving while the sun over there. Yeah, in the matter time, yeah, even if there's a sun always. For example, now on Earth we have in a polar, North Pole and South Pole, 6 months they will stay with the sun, 6 months with no sun. Time does not stop. They will count 6 months. But I'm saying under the physics of different body, Allah Azza wa Jal, He will not make you grow old anymore. We will always stay the same age in heaven, inshaAllah. So when he said, وَكَانَ قَابَ خَوْسَيْنَ أَوَنَّ in this ayah, he's meaning like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he entered as Muhammad, he entered the ultimate nur for Ahmad. He entered that place. You know, كَانَ قَابَ خَوْسَيْنِ. You see the sun, how it's hitting the moon? Okay, it is like that, sun and moon together. It's the ray of the sun is going to the moon, and the moon is reflecting that to Earth. So, at that time, nobody can deny that Imam Ali was not there. In the night of 14, everyone will see the moon, right? Before, some people they will say, no, this crescent, no, it's not the moon. Maybe it's just a piece of something, wood or something over there. Some people, let's say we bring someone. He never seen the sky before, and we tell him, look, this is a moon, this is a planet, this is a round planet. He will say, no, it's not round planet, impossible to be round. So we'll start see it forming, and then growing. The 14th, you see it full planet. And then after that, it will fade away. And then it will be what? Not seen anymore. But can scientists see it? Yes. Imam Ali was like that. He said in one of the narration, كنت معا الأنبياء في الخفاء. I was with all prophet in secret, in hidden secret. وكنت مع رسول الله في العالم. So when Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم was there, his son, nobody can be under a shadow anymore. You see? Nobody, when you have ultimate nur, nobody can hide anymore. Everything can be seen very clear. So when at the time of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, Imam Ali could not hide anymore. Because it's impossible. It is like the night of 14. It has to reflect all the nur of Rasulullah. So Imam Ali was wasi Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam over there. This is the understanding. So this is now we explain just the first part. وَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنَ وَأَدْنَى. He was close to something. Now we know he was close to his nur, to his ultimate nur, Ahmad. طيب. What does it mean after that? دَنَا فَتَدَلَّ. دَنَا, and then he. Then tadalla from something. Tadalla mean he came in inside out. It's a little complicated. I'll show you in more movies now to see what is it exactly. Type. In between the meem and the ayn in Arabic, the letter meem and ayn, I will show you a proof now that you need eight ayn. You know how, do you know how ayn was Israel? You know how was it? Ayn? Like number three in English, but you flip it this way, ayin, is like that, yeah, you write it like that. You need 8 of these to make one meme, one number meme. I'll show you how. At the very end, we will conclude to see what exactly will carry the throne of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What? Yeah, because in Surah Az-Zumar, what Allah Azza wa Jal said, وَأَشْرَقَتْ الْأَرْضُ بِنُورِ رَبِّهَا. And then after that, the throne of Allah will come. And eight things are carrying this throne.
You said the throne of
Rahman. Yes, Arshullah. Arshul Rahman. The throne of Allah. What do you mean by throne of Allah? Does Allah يعني sit in a throne? What do I mean by throne of Allah? Who knows? No, Rasulullah, when he's sitting on his real powers, then he is the throne of Allah. He is representing Allah Azza wa Jal. When you have someone, he's showing you all his what he can do, in reality, there's no more hidden things in Alam Yawm Al-Qiyamah. You will see everything in reality. So you will see what is Muhammad, the ultimate Muhammad. Yani you see Ahmad. And Ahmad, he's gonna come just like this, with no throne, sitting on a throne, and eight things are carrying him. No, he's gonna become like this. He's a king. Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned him as a king in the Quran. Okay. So, we will continue. We will see those phases. I wanna take you now to what is Dana Fatadalla mean? Yani, then he drew near, then he bowed. Bowed to what? That in the explanation here, in the translation from Arabic to English, they said he's bowed. But that he didn't bow. It's not that tadalla mean bow. I'll show you now, inshallah, what is it exactly. Now it's gonna be a little complicated. I hope you stay with me. We have something in biology. You see, look how everything's connected together. First, we spoke about matter, with the formation of matter. Second, we spoke about the moon, that yani what exactly we always see. And then we're gonna speak about the foundation of us. What exactly found us before? We have something that called the volvox. Have anybody heard about volvox before? Volvox are like cells, you know, like round cells, and every cell has 8 points in it. Subhanallah. And it's like volvox is calling us, hey, come see what exactly I do. And then in a volvox, for it to evolve, it what made us as a human. It what made us interested in other sex. For example, made us male and female. This volvox. We're talking, when we said male and female, we're talking about what? About duality. Now we are duals as a human being. We're not dual from the kingdom way. We're talking about duality. What does duality mean in volvox? If you see it over here, I'm showing you those pictures. This is real images. You see over in a corner, there are big points, big dots. And every volvox has only 8 dots, 8 big dots. And many, many different dots are surrounding that. The volvox is the only organism that for it to start evolving, it has to flip inside out. Yani what's inside, it has to go and then flip out. Like this. Yani the circle, all of it. Let's imagine this is as a volvox. The inside will come outside. Yani inside you, it's like you're turning this inside out. Okay, this is how volvox start evolving. When this evolve happen, what's happened exactly for us to become us? Volvox start as at the beginning as something called genox. This is how they started. And then after that, they start making families. Why we are interested in families now? For you to become from a singular person to a family, right? You want to make family. And then after that, this family will start making order. Yani they make like a system together, as for example now we have a law system and so on. Those volvox, that they don't have a brain, they start making order. And then after that they make class. They start classing themselves. But this volvox is very beautiful, this one is not really. Those people, they go to this one and they start making classes. Not classes as a learning classes, no class. We call it yani dividing society. And then after that, they start making phylum. Phylum mean like big groups. For example, now we make parties together. Those people are against those people. This is how they start making it. And then after that, they start making kingdoms. Yani, for example, they have one volvox who is responsible about all those the other volvox. And then later, they start making domain. Domain, what do I mean by domain? For example, these people, as Volvox, they do this thing. For example, let's say engineering. Those ones are doctors, those ones are so on. And later, at the very end, the life itself started, as we know it now. Yani Allah Azza wa Jal, if those people that believe in evolution, they're gonna be happy. They said, you see, look, everything existed on those Volvox before us. No, in reality, Allah Azza wa Jal, He is showing us those Volvox, because if those Volvox became us, then why those Volvox still in existence? They should be humans too, right? But we see those Volvox, why? To understand how we are embedded inside us. Yani, for example, life to start, something has to flip inside out in reality. And how many phases I spoke about Volvox now? Did you count them? 8 phases. Again, number 8 came in. Anything involved with life, number 8 will come up. Anything involved with creating life, a number 8 will come up. Anything we're speaking about, throne of life, the throne of life, throne of Allah Azza wa Jal, is number 8. Will pop up. طيب. As number 8 keep popping up, what is it exactly? We're going to the ayah that say, وَيَحْمِلُ عَرْشَ رَبِّكَ فَوْقَ إِذٍ ثَمَانٍ. 8 things will carry the throne of Allah Azza wa Jal. Let's speak about those volvox. To flip inside out, can a ball of energy, nur, flip inside out? Let's say, for example, if we bring energy now, this is full of light, nur. Can it be inside out? Can the nur come from inside outside? Yeah, but can we do it the same way that the volvox is doing? The volvox, what will happen? She will draw like a hole in the middle over here. In the head, like a pole, and then it will put her body inside, and then it will flip. Can the energy do that? No, it does not do that, because energy has a form that always in the middle has to be an existence to form everything around it. Same thing like Earth. Earth, in the middle we have a core, and this core will keep everything together. So if we want to flip something, if we want to flip Earth, what's going to happen? Yani all Earth gonna bend together, and then from we destroy everything, and that is impossible. Now the science of the meem and ayin come to existence over here. We have a scientist that they call it Mobius strip. Mobius strip is Allah Azza wa Jal, when He starts speaking about the circles in the Quran, He did not speak about spheres. There's big difference between a circle, your tables are circle now, and a sphere. Can we flip a circle inside out? Can you flip now this one inside outside?
No.
No, you can't. Can we flip this one inside outside? Yes. Okay, we have a science that from this guy called Mobius. Mobius strip, look over here. What exactly Mobius strip? This, we have a strip, like a circle strip. If you want to flip it inside out, the only way you can do it, just bend it over like this, little bit, and this form will come up to life. But it will never flip completely away. From flipping from this, did you all see it?
Mm-hmm.
Did you see it? Okay. From, I will show you different one, important, because it is important to see how number 8 came to existence. Okay. This guy, I want you to learn something very important. Number 8, the English numbers originally, for example, the one you take in classes now, are originally Arabic, Arabic language. For example, number 1 you take in class 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, the regular one we study it over here in the American curriculum, is their Arabic numbers. They're not English number. They were taken from us, and then we, because we're so smart, we took the Indian's system, numbering system. The Indian number system does not make any sense in the formation of the universe. These numbers now, over here, they make the real formation of the universe. If we bring Mobius strip now, and we want to connect number 8, look, this guy. What did he do exactly? He took like a regular band, rubber band, but made from paper, and then he put line in the middle, and he start cutting it. What do you expect we're going to have when you cut this one? Two circles inside each other. And there are two circles like this inside it. What this will represent? Number 8. So the Mobius strip, if you cut it, you cut the half, cut it in half, You make it dual, what's gonna have? What you gonna have? Number eight. Have you ever seen the magician before? They will show you, like, they have just one strip like this, and then suddenly they make something, and then there's two together. How did he make it? Yeah, no, it's just one piece, one part, but you don't see it, it's divided from inside. When he starts playing his hand like this, suddenly you see two circles inside each other. Why? Because they are exactly like that, like this mobile strip. So, number eight, to come to existence, you have to have one circle to cut it inside in the middle, and then flipping this together will have number eight. You see, we go back to the foundation of universe again. Number eight. Type. This is only happening on with the circles. That what about this? Can we make this same thing? One of the rules of flipping circles, one of these rules, it's very important to understand this. Because understanding how we flip a circle, the sphere inside out, basically you will understand what is it exactly the throne of Rasulullah, how it's gonna look like. Okay. Now we have a scientist that he lived in 1930 maybe, and then he's a mathematician. He had a struggle about flipping a circle inside out, you know. At that time there was no Shia, and Iran didn't exist for him to find him, so we can later claim that Shia are right, or Islam is right, you see. And this person, he was a scientist, he was not Muslim. He never heard about Islam. Those scientists, Allah Azza wa Jal, he sent them the science. So for us to to see the reality, look over here. In this picture over here, I want to show you, if you see it, if you get closer, over this one, you see a circle, right? Over here in the corner, at the very corner. You see a circle. I have a movie, I want you to watch it at the very end, but for you to understand, what do I mean? Every eighth ayn will make one meme. Meme is look like a womb. The real meme is like a sphere. Allah Azza wa Jal, when he called Muhammad as Muhammad, at the beginning of his name is a sphere. At the beginning, it's not a circle, it's a sphere. This is how the Nur of Ahmad is, a sphere, like a sun. But imagine it as a big sun. Over here, if you want to flip the inside out, what's going to happen? You draw over here, you make it like a, you know, when you cut a batikha or oranges, yeah, watermelon. If you cut it like this, you cut, but we're not cutting, we're pushing eight places. This scientist, he proved that only need eight places, you push it inside. So from meme, we're having, in Arabic, how we write the ayn? It was like a cake, right? It's like a crescent. Crescent, right? The ayn is like a crescent. So from meme, we have eight crescents. Eight ayn. Okay, look. وَيَحْمِلُ عَرْشَ رَبِّكَ فَوْقَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ what? ثَمَانِيَ. You see? We're remembering this ayah. Okay. After that, the inside will start coming out. Look. After pushing that, the inside will start coming up. The fifth phase. In this one, we have eight phases to become a reality. I drew more picture inside this one for us to understand it more. But we have eight phases, so the circle can flip inside out. Not the circle, the sphere, I'm sorry. And then over here, who can, in the middle, over here in the corner, what do you see? We see again the flower of life happening. You see? You see the flower of life happening? Do you see it over there in the corner? In the second line over there? Mm-hmm. In the other side? The flower of life is happening again. So now we know how the flower of life came into existence from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And how many places are, how many ayn are forming? Eight. That's very unique. And then we continue the very end, that the circle is flipped inside out. What do I mean by the circle flipping inside out? We're translating this ayah, فَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنَ أَوَدْنَا. He was close to this nur as between two arrows. ثم دنا فتدلى. The ayah دنا فتدلى before كان قاب قوسين أدنى. In دعاء السمات is very important. Dua is important to read it always the last hour of Friday, like now. دنا فتدلى فكان قاب قوسين أدنى. He continue in دعاء السمات من العلي الأعلى. Yeah, dunuwan wa iqtiraban min al-'ali al-a'la. Who is 'Ali al-a'la? Yeah, because we are speaking about Muhammad al-a'la Muhammad over here, his name Ahmad, right? Allah Azza wa Jal, he said, you're Ali over here, Ali ala al-ard, is Ali al-A'la over there. He's not speaking about Ali al-A'la as God. You see, this is where the ulama start missing. The one he said, dunuwan wa iqtiraban min al-Ali al-A'la, he's not Allah, because if he's Allah, then Allah, he exists in a place. And that's impossible. So al-Ali al-A'la is Imam Ali. And then later in one of ayahs he said, ثُمَّ رَآهُ نَزْلَةً أُخْرَى. When he finished from that, he came down to the throne of Allah. He left the nur. He came to the throne of Allah. ثُمَّ رَآهُ نَزْلَةً أُخْرَى عَنْدَ سِدْرَةِ الْمُنْتَهَى. Ulama, عَنْدَ سِدْرَةِ الْمُنْتَهَى, it's under the arsh, the throne of Allah. He saw someone back the second time. I'm reading ayat from the Quran. He saw him second time over there. Tab ulama, he said, saw who? They said Gabriel. He saw Gabriel again. But Gabriel was with him. How did he see him? He was all the trip with him. Why he wanna see him second? All the trip he came, he left him there, and then he finished from doing dana fatadalla. He came outside, and Allah Azza wa Jal, he said, ثُمَّ رَآهُ نَزْلَةً أُخْرَى, he saw him second time, and the Sidrat al-Muntaha. Tab Gabriel always was with him. All the time. وَمَا شو, and then in different ayah he said, وَمَا صَاحِبُكُمْ بِمَجْنُونَ. صَاحِبُكُمْ, يعني رسول الله, is not crazy. وَقَدْ رَآهُ فِي الْأُفُقِ الْمُبِينَ, he saw him, he saw Ali. It's not Gabriel, because everyone, he know Gabriel always be seen by Rasulullah. Why the people, they want to claim he's crazy? Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told them that Ali is Batin Muhammad. And I saw him over there. And people, they said, oh, look, this crazy man. He's talking about his cousin as he saw him over there. You see, now things make sense, because when we say why those Sahaba said about Rasulullah crazy, but they believe in Gabriel, they know Gabriel is always keep bringing him ayat. So why those Sahaba, the mu'mineen of Allah, Muslimin, they already Muslims, they said about Rasulullah crazy? Why? Because now he's talking about Imam Ali alayhi salam. So from the science of turning the sphere inside out, that one of the scientists, mathematics scientists, he spent all his life proving it. Nobody know why he's doing that. People, some of them, they thought this is very useless science. Allah Azza wa Jal, basically he sent us science now to tell us how Muhammad gave Ali. The button of Muhammad came outside. You see, and came outside by how many circles? By how many ayn? 8 ayins. And Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned this 8 ayin in the Quran. وَيَحْمِلُ عَرْشَ رَبِّكَ فَوْقَهُمْ ثَمَانِيَةً. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on his throne, Yawm al-Qiyamah, is gonna come, who's gonna carry him? 8 sides of Imam Ali alayhi salam. Why 8 sides? Who knows? Why not just one Imam Ali carrying him? I said 8 sides of Imam Ali because Imam Ali has different sides. Huh? Yes, but no, only one. Yeah, but when we start talking about the nafs, remember, we start talking the body and then the nafs inside us. Nafs, yani yourself. How many nafs do you have inside you? Four. We have 8. Oh, 8. Imam Ali spoke about those 8, and each one is representing. If we are representing this nafs, you are one inside you, right? You don't have 8 inside you, but you have an-nafs al-ammara bis-su. النفس المطمئنة, النفس الغاضبة, النفس الحيوانية, النفس 8. If you count them 8, Imam Ali said that. Why nobody made a relationship between this and this? ما هو Imam Ali is the batin of Rasulullah. So 8 of Imam Ali as one will make one Rasulullah. You see how everything is connecting? Do we have a proof about that? Who knows? When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Imam Ali, they were going to destroy the idols. You know the story, right? As a respect of Rasulullah, and this is what should be done, Imam Ali tried to lift Rasulullah, right? And then he wanna lift him to put him in the Kaaba so he can destroy. He could not lift him. Imam Ali couldn't lift Rasulullah to put him in the Kaaba to destroy the throne. Why? The idols. Why? Because he cannot carry all this knowledge. Nobody can carry the ilm of Rasulullah. Nobody can carry the how heavy is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Knowing Imam Ali, knowing as Shia, as Muslims, we should know that Rasulullah is better than Ali 8 times. From this science, I'm not speaking from my head. We always as much as we love Imam Ali, always Rasulullah is better than Imam Ali 8 times. And nobody knows one of these times how big it is. Is it? How? What is the density of it? You see what I mean? I don't mean you need only 8 Imam Ali's. No. The density of this knowledge has to be so big to carry that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what happened in the Kaaba? Rasulullah told Imam Ali to go upstairs. So Imam Ali was carried by Rasulullah. He put his hand, you know, he put him out. Did any one of you saw the Kaaba before? You know how tall is it? It's like 3 stories tall. Why nobody asked how Imam Ali did he reach there? By it. So yani Rasulullah, he throw him like this and he reached 3 levels? No. This is a miracle. When Rasulullah is carrying you, Imam Ali said, from his narration said, he said, you know, when I put my hand in the Kaaba, my hand could reach any stars over there and it will be even more than that. Yani it's not just ultimate to go on the Kaaba. No, it is more than that. He could reach anything. This is will take us to the last week lecture when we spoke about the whale, right? When Rasulullah ordered Imam Ali to reach the whale to take the devil away from it, right? Remember this story? So this is how Imam Ali came to existence. This is the existence of Imam Ali. Subhanallah. So based on that, Rasulullah is the foundation. He's the dhahir. Everybody know him. He's like a sun, and Imam Ali is like the moon. So he was able to go in the Kaaba and destroy all the idols over there. So based on all these things, I want you to listen to, I'm gonna be at the very end of this lecture, it's like a 10 minute, to see how the circle was flipped inside out with all the laws. Because it has laws, you cannot just flip it inside out, because it's an energy. It's not just a physical form. Because in a physical form, I can make a hole over here and then take it out, right? It will be like same thing like volvox. But volvox are matter, are organism. Yani it's touchable. The energy, can someone store energy? Like I have a battery. Yeah, I can store like a battery. But can I store light? I cannot store light. I cannot have a battery of lights. When I open it, I can take some lights and then put it back. No, I cannot do that. So because he is light, this scientist showed us how it is done when you flip it inside out. So do you have any question about it? Inshallah, and we're gonna watch this movie, and you can search it on YouTube, because they have like a 2-hour movie, different movies, how to flip the circle inside out. And inside this one, you will see 8 ayns from the meme, like circle, yani they're forming from the meme, and how the things inside out came up. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
Out. Yes, that's true.
What's the big deal? Just poke a hole in it and pull it through.
Sure, but the point is to do it without making a hole.
But then it seems impossible.
You're right. You cannot do it with an ordinary sphere, like a basketball. You have to understand the rules of the game. This sphere is made of an abstract elastic material that can stretch and bend and pass through itself. But you cannot rip or puncture this material without destroying it. And you cannot crease it or bend it sharply.
If the surface can pass through itself, what's the problem?
Do you think allowing self-intersections makes it easy? Try it.
I'll push the 2 halves right through each other.
Be careful. What about that ring around the equator? Remember, you mustn't tear or crease it.
Let me try again.
That's no good either. You're pinching it infinitely tight.
But then there's no way. It's impossible. You'd have to crease or pinch it to turn it inside out.
It is surprising, but watch this.
Is this it? Is this a sphere turning inside out?
You bet. That wasn't easy to follow, was it? To figure out what's going on, let's look at something simpler. A circle. We'll build a vertical wall along the circle so that we can color the 2 sides differently. Can you gradually turn this circle into this other circle? where the purple and gold sides are reversed without creating sharp corners?
Of course. I can turn a rubber band inside out.
Remember, we're really trying to turn the circle inside out. We only built the wall so we could see the different sides.
Oh, yes. The wall has to stay vertical, and it can't have creases, but it can pass through itself. Fine. Let me try.
Watch out. That was a sharp bend. If we could make sharp bends in the material, we'd be able to turn any curve into any other by moving each point of the initial curve in a straight line toward a target point in the final curve.
But I can avoid corners altogether by making a loop smaller and smaller.
That's an interesting idea, but pulling a loop tight is not really a gradual change. It's like having a corner in disguise. So it's against the rules.
Well, if you can't have corners, and you can't pull loops tight, I think it's impossible to turn the circle inside out.
Yes, you're right.
Wait a minute. Am I supposed to believe that you can turn a sphere inside out, but not a circle?
Yes. There is something fundamental about curves that would have to change if you were to turn a circle inside out. And that something cannot change under our allowed motions.
And what's that?
I'll explain. Imagine a monorail atop the wall. Now, the rule about monorail traffic is that the car only travels forward and it always keeps the purple wall on its right. We'll use a diagram to monitor the car's direction. On this track, the car is always turning left. As it goes around the circle once, it makes one full turn toward the left. On a more complicated track, the car might sometimes be turning left and sometimes right. But the net amount of turning after one complete circuit is always some number of full turns in one direction or the other. The number of full turns it makes toward the left is called the curve's turning number. For a curve where there is more turning toward the right than toward the left, the turning number is negative.
Hey, and if there's no net turning, the turning number is zero.
Right.
I had a hard time following the net turning for this winding track.
That's natural, but there's another way to get the right answer. Find the spots where you're traveling in a particular direction, like due east.
Let's see. Since we're looking from the south, that would be wherever the monorail is going toward our right, where we see the purple wall face on.
Exactly. At some of these points, the track is curving away from us. Viewed from here, it looks like a smile. At these places, the car would be turning left. At others, the track looks like a frown. Curving toward us, at these points, the car would be turning right. The net number of full turns increases when the car passes a smile and decreases when it passes a frown, starting at zero. 1, 2, 3, 4, 3, 2, and we finish with 3. The turning number is the number of smiles minus the number of frowns.
I see. The turning number measures happiness.
If you insist. Now, the nice thing about the turning number is that it remains the same when a curve changes according to our rules. Frowns and smiles can appear or disappear, but only in pairs that balance out. The number of smiles minus the number of frowns never changes.
So a curve can only turn into another curve with the same turning number.
Right. The turning number is the fundamental property I mentioned before. Now, what's the turning number for the two circles?
This one has one smile and no frowns, so the turning number is 1. And if the gold is outside, one frown and no smiles, minus 1. It makes sense. On one curve, you're turning left all the time. On the other, it's the opposite.
Good. So the reason you cannot turn a circle inside out
is that that would change the turning number. But wait, doesn't the same argument prove that you can't turn a sphere inside out? This sphere has a three-dimensional smile, and this one has a three-dimensional frown. So they have different turning numbers.
Not quite. Your analogy is good, but to make it complete, we must look at a general surface and consider all the points where it is horizontal and gold is on top. We'll draw horizontal stripes to make these points easier to locate. Smiles are like bowls, curving up. Frowns are like domes, curving down. But there are other points where the surface is horizontal that are neither bowls nor domes. They are saddles and look like smiles from one direction and frowns from another. Near a bowl or a dome, the horizontal stripes form rings. Near a saddle, they form an X.
But how does that change anything? Spheres don't have saddles.
Ah, but the point is how these features interact. Look, a dome and a saddle can come together and cancel out. Likewise, a bowl and a saddle can cancel out. But bowls and domes, like electrical charges of the same sign, normally don't get near each other. The unchanging number for surfaces, then, is this. Add domes and bowls and subtract saddles. This number is one for the sphere no matter which face is out.
Okay, I'm willing to believe that turning numbers don't prevent the sphere from turning inside out as they do the circle, but that doesn't mean you can actually do it.
We'll get to that. I know it's hard to see. Steve Smale proved it was possible in theory in 1957, but it took 7 years before Arnold Shapiro found a practical way to do it. Since the problem remained hard to visualize, more methods were invented later by Bernard Morin and several others. I'll show you Bill Thurston's method, invented in 1974. Let's go back to curves for a bit. Remember that this circle can only be changed into curves of turning number one.
Still not allowing sharp corners, right?
Of course. Now, can the circle be turned into any curve of turning number one? Say, this one?
Let's see. I'll try to go backwards from this curve to the circle. I think I got it. There.
Excellent. Now try this one.
I'll undo this loop first and push this fold back. Now here. Here we go.
Very good. And this one?
Whoa. You're not going to ask me to do every single curve of turning number one, are you?
Of course not. What we need is a general method. Do you remember the simple way to transform one curve to another when sharp bends are allowed?
Yes. You just go straight from one to the other.
That's the one. When the curves have the same turning number, this method can be adapted to work without sharp bends. The trick is to add waves to the curve.
Can we do it on a simpler one?
Sure. We start by marking small pieces of the curve that will serve as guides for the transformation. We'll concentrate on these segments now. We move the centers of the guide segments straight toward their final destinations on the circle, without any rotation. Next, we rotate the guides so that they are lined up with the circle.
Okay, what about the parts in between?
That's where the waviness comes in. We make the connecting segments between adjacent guides bulge out into corrugations. This allows the segments to move freely around each other as long as they remain more or less parallel.
Oh, I see. The guides can move around without creating sharp bends.
Correct. Here is the transformation of the whole curve.
The original curve in blue develops sharp corners, but the wavy curve is springy enough to remain smooth throughout.
We have to keep adjacent guides roughly parallel as we rotate them to align with the circle. This is possible as long as the turning number of the original curve is 1.
Why can't we align the guides if the turning number isn't 1?
Watch what happens when we try to turn a figure 8 into a circle. And here, both the initial and final curve have turning number 0. Using this method, or others, you can always transform one curve into another with the same turning number. This is called the Whitney-Grafstein theorem.
And what does this have to do with the sphere?
A lot. Think of the sphere as a stack of circles, deformed into a barrel shape and closed off by caps above and below. Just as we made our curves more pliable by dividing them into guide segments connected by waves, we divide the barrel into guide strips that alternate with wavy strips. The waviness dies out at the top and bottom, so as to match the caps.
This is going to get complicated.
Then for now, let's look at a single guide strip along with the caps. Start by pushing the two caps past each other.
Before, when I pushed the poles through, it made a crease.
Stop before the crease, when the guide has a loop in the middle. Now we turn the two caps in opposite directions, because we want to convert the loop in the middle to twisting at the ends.
Oh, I know. It's like a belt. If you put a loop in the middle and pull the ends tight, the loop turns into twisting.
Right. Then you can straighten out the belt by turning each end half a turn in opposite directions. To finish the eversion, we just need to push the middle of the guide strip back through the center of the sphere.
Can I see how two guide strips interact?
Sure. You can see that there are two places where the strips intersect near the central axis.
And the gold signs that started facing out are now facing in.
Here is the whole process with all the guides.
The polar caps just move up and down and then rotate into place. Ah, that's why they don't require any springiness.
Exactly. Now let's look at two guides and the corrugation between them, from a pole to the equator. This chunk is the fundamental building block of the eversion. The whole sphere is made from 16 rotated copies of this piece.
That looks pretty complicated.
Yes, but the corrugation is just following the twisting of the guide strips that you saw before.
Can I see that from pole to pole?
Yes. The corrugation provides flexibility between the guides so that their motion does not create any pinches or creases, just like the waves in the curve that we saw before.
Let me see the whole thing.
We corrugate the connecting strips between the guides and push the caps past each other. We twist the caps to undo the middle loops and push the equator across the sphere. Finally, we uncorrugate.
I still don't understand. Is there some other way to look at this?
Okay. We'll divide the sphere into thin horizontal ribbons. We'll look at one ribbon at a time. You can see the North Pole push down into the south. A ribbon near the pole is rather tame. The guide segments keep their position relative to one another, and the corrugations never get very deep. Ribbons closer to the equator are wilder, so we'll split the screen to see what's going on. On the right, The camera tracks the ribbon from above, so its apparent size does not change. This overhead view highlights the symmetries that are hidden in the side view on the left, where we see the position of the ribbon in space. At the equator, the ribbon just twists and doesn't move up or down.
Wait a minute. This ribbon looks just like the wall under the monorail, and it's turning inside out. You had finally convinced me that that was impossible.
I'll play that again. Remember that our walls represented circles and had to stay vertical. But here the ribbon can twist around in space because it's part of a sphere. Another way to understand the eversion is to progressively build up the surface of the sphere at a few important stages. This is the corrugation phase. Now we've just pushed the caps through each other. This is the middle of the twisting phase. We can see the complex activity at the equator. At the end of the twisting phase, the corrugations have nearly become figure eights. Here, we're in the middle of pushing horizontally through the center of the sphere. Finally, we show the uncorrugation phase. The sphere is now entirely purple.
Wow. I think I'm ready to see the whole thing again.
Here goes.
You were right. You can turn a sphere inside out without poking holes or creasing it, even though you can't do it for a circle. This is great. Somebody should make a movie about this stuff.